spending 12 months living and working in Antarctica would hold little appeal for many of us, but that's exactly what one young Victorian woman's about to do in what she describes as the adventure of a lifetime. Nick Johnston has the story.
For the past 4 years, Rachael Robertson has called Victoria's West Coast home. As Parks Victoria's chief ranger, she's been responsible for maintaining our pristine coastline. But now she's about to trade all this for wilderness of a different kind, heading to remote Davis Station in Antarctica for what promises to be the adventure of a lifetime.
Good luck. You know, down there you're going to need to keep warm, so there's a hot water bottle for you. Also, Tim Tams. You can't go anywhere without your Tim Tams. Also, some fire lighters, because it could get a bit chilly in the old igloo.
So ladies and gentlemen, could you please welcome Rachael Robertson.
You're chosen by the Australian government to lead an expedition to Antarctica was a real honour and a real privilege for me, and to be able to come along here this morning and talk to you and share some of those stories gives me great joy, because I get to relive the year over again. The only reason I applied for this job in the first place was to find out what questions they were asking at the interview so I could bring them back to my organisation. What I know now that I didn't know then, they don't have an interview for the role of station leader. They have a week-long boot camp, and it was here at our fire training in Hobart before we'd even left for Antarctica. And we're on our hands and knees in this smoke-filled shipping container, and it was real smoke, real flames, pitch black. We had to crawl through the dark with an oxygen tank on our back and breathing apparatus on our faces, and crawl through the dark and grab the ankle of the guy in front of us and find this 80 kilogram life-size mannequin and drag it to safety. And I put my hand out to grab the ankle of the guy in front of me, and I couldn't find his foot, I couldn't feel it, and I thought, whoa, this is not what I thought I'd signed up for. And I honestly just wanted to get up and run away right there and then. But then I realised, you know, I was the leader of the expedition, and I couldn't ask these 17 men and women to trust me with their lives in Antarctica if I fell at the first hurdle in Hobart. This is our resupply ship, and that's how we get down there. And this is home, this is where we live for 12 months. Davis. I'm not an explorer. I'm not an adventurer. I'm not Kay Cotty. I'm not Jessica Watson. I'm not climbing Everest like Bridget Muir. Actually, I'm more Bridget Jones than Bridget Muir. I found out that icebergs form when they carve off the end of a glacier, and the speed and the frequency that they come off the end tells us about climate change. So in terms of global warming, it's probably one of the most important sciences we have. We had email. We had eBay. The guys spent a lot of time on eBay, you know, even though obviously they couldn't get anything delivered. I look at this photo, and even now I still get butterflies in my stomach, because this is the day that the summer crew go home. And I remember standing there with the 17 men and women staying with me thinking, this is it. This is it. I won't see another face. For the next 9 months, these people are my world. They're my family, they're my friends, they're my colleagues, they're my community, they're my social network, they're my life for the next 9 months. So it's a very big emotional day when the summer crew go home and leave us behind, as you can imagine. You physically can't get out of Antarctica in winter. It's impossible. One of the challenges for me as the leader was bringing together a very diverse group of people and getting them functioning as a team. And I didn't care if everybody loved everybody. It's impractical to think that 18 strangers thrown together around the clock in total isolation are all going to get along, but we had to at least work together, you know, because our lives depended on it. The sexual tension was so big, but so unspoken, you know, like an elephant in the room, that nobody wanted to compliment someone on their appearance just in case they misconstrued or misinterpreted and got the wrong end of the stick, and, oh no, this person's got a crush on me and how will I avoid them for the next 6 months? And it's all very awkward. So a couple of personality clashes early on in the piece, and one particular clash was between an electrical engineer from Germany and a plumber from Mudgee. Go figure, huh? Different people. Both absolutely terrific guys, wonderful guys, but just different. They just thought differently, communicate differently, different sense of humour, just different. And they clashed. And my job was to get them working as a team. And I found that by putting them in a team where the outcome was very explicit, now there's no politics around what are we trying to achieve, they started to work together. So at the end of the year, the plumber came up to me and he was talking about the engineer. And he said to me, he's not a bad bloke, you know, that Peter. That's high praise from an Australian tradie. We had home brew and we had 6 home brewers and 2 chief brewers in case one of the chief brewers was ever off station. One of the other challenges for me as a leader was understanding why people work in Antarctica, and it's no different to any workplace in the world. People come to work for different reasons. So it was important that I not only matched people to what they were good at, but to what they enjoyed doing. You know, you really need to celebrate those short-term wins along the way, because if you wait until the change is over, it's too late and you lose morale. And I learnt that one pretty early on. Plus, you've got to have fun. Speaking of conference dinners, this is our bachelor's and spinster's ball. And the plumber had this for his birthday. I emailed this home to my brother and he said to me, all you guys do is have parties. So, well, we don't really, but, you know, we have a birthday each, but not everyone has a party for their birthday. But from May till August, we can't go outside. It's pitch black. There's no wildlife. The wildlife's all gone. There's a few emperor penguins, but you won't see them in winter. So there's nothing going on outside. So the focus becomes in here, on us. So if we don't have something to look forward to in the next week or two, we start picking on each other. We focus on each other. So it's really important to have these social events to give us something to focus on. So I've noticed there's a few women here this morning, so I'm going to point out for the ladies in particular. That's me in the green satin dress. That is not my green satin dress. I found it in a dress-up box down there. I just wouldn't want a single one of you walking out of here thinking, why would that woman pack a green satin dress to go to Antarctica? But it really came home to me that my behaviour was being scrutinised in a way that I hadn't even imagined, hadn't even entered my head. And, you know, things I was doing and saying and where I sat for meals was being watched and interpreted. But when you're in a leadership position, you are being watched. And, you know, so I had to be really careful with dress-ups. In this case, I'm wearing a lab coat, which is kind of with the Rocky Horror theme. I could have gone as Frankenfurter, you know, like Mark beside me, and worn a short skirt and suspenders. But that's not appropriate for the leader. And once you cross that line, it's very difficult to come back from. So I had to put a lot of thought into what I wore for dress-ups. But if you'd said to me, what's the difference between -5 degrees and -35 degrees before I went, I would have said, I don't know, -5 degrees is cold, -35 degrees is really cold. My hand got cold. I had 3 pairs of gloves on, but my hand got cold. So I took my hand out of the gloves to scrunch it up into a fist just to get some feeling in my fingertips and shove it back in the glove really quickly. But in just those few seconds, I damaged my fingertips, you know, and I had no feeling in them for about 8 months. Your immune system is wrecked because bugs and viruses can't live in these temperatures. So you're perfectly healthy for 12 months. But as soon as a new person comes on station, or you get back to the real world, you get every bug and virus going around. I had a cough for about 8 months when I got back, and it wasn't that I was sick, it was just my immune system was building itself back up again. And none of this was in the brochure. The brochure was all emperor penguins and glaciers and icebergs. You know, there was nothing about immune systems. And Graham and I met in training, and we just hit it off. We just really clicked, and he was, you know, obviously my peer at the other station. But that peer support was just gold, you know, to be able to ring him up and have someone who knows what you're going through, and you can talk in the shorthand. And that's why, you know, again, your conference today is so important, and the dinner last night, and morning tea and lunch, and any opportunity that you can get to talk to people who are going through what you're going through and live, you know, some of the challenges that you live. Were there times where you wanted to go home? Oh, yeah, absolutely. I'm sure there were times we all wanted to go home. But one of the ways that I built up my own resilience was to focus on the things I had rather than the things I'd given up. We had a formal dinner every Saturday night and we all got dressed up for dinner. Well, dressed up, I mean the girls put lipstick on and the boys had a shave, but I put out an email every couple of hours saying, look, the guys are fine, they've got 10 days worth of food on board, we've got 4 days worth of bad weather, we'll get them home. And we did, we got them back on day 5. And it doesn't matter whether it's a plane crash, a natural disaster, a financial crisis, Woolworths moving into the trade space, whatever that tough time is, or that challenging time is, the rules are exactly the same for the leader. Because I knew that people were watching me. I knew my community were watching me to see whether they should be worried or anxious. And so I was highly visible. I talked about an incident, not an accident. And I talked about a retrieval, not a rescue. You'd be optimistic because people are looking for leadership, particularly, you know, in the tough times. Your staff are looking and they're worrying about their jobs, you know, whether their job's going to be safe. But it taught me a whole lot about the role of a leader through those difficult times, that people watch you. I learned so much just by every day. I actually kept a journal, but every day I could look back at my day and think, what did I do well? What didn't work? What would I never do again? And I learnt, and I could adapt my style every day just by taking the time to reflect. This place where there's no war, and there's no crime, and there's no poverty, and there's no trespassers will be prosecuted signs. And we didn't even have Collingwood supporters. Utopia. Yeah, but the women of Antarctica have a saying that the odds are good, but the goods are odd. So I will leave you on that note. Thank you very much for having me, and please enjoy the rest of your conference. Thank you.
I thought she was marvellous. The empathy she talked about, it just came across so well. And what she's learned over that time, being in Antarctica, she must have come back a different person and so well, you know, so well versed in how to deal with people now.
Her leadership skills that she went through were a great starting point for us to look at.
Initially she had some trepidations and some setbacks, but she knew that there was a job to be done and it was important, and she committed to it and worked her way around it and succeeded in the end.
Very brave. Really, very brave, particularly because when she went into the project, she didn't really know what she was in for.
File and the insight she gave into getting the best out of people.
It would have been hard for her, but she seemed like a very, I mean, I don't know her personally, but she seemed like a very strong person.
I think in terms of getting on with people and looking for the best result, I learned a lot from what she said, you know, taking time out to reflect about things, keeping a journal, and being careful of people's feelings.
Well, with all the changes that are going through in our industry, there may well be struggles, but if you knuckle down as a team and work out a strategy to overcome that, you can be successful ultimately.
Beautiful photos. Love to go there one day.
Oh, I was close to tears.
Yeah. Very motivating.
I thought it was inspirational.
It was fantastic. We really enjoyed it. Very inspirational.